For some of us, it was an awesome time to be around. It was full of great memories, putting on your best Famous Stars and Straps shirt, your Dickies and Draven shoes, and going to the mall and trying unsuccessfully to flirt with the girl who works at Jamba Juice. What's up, everybody? I'm Finn McKenty. This is the Punk Rock NBA, and welcome back to my What Killed the Genre series, where I look at genres that have fallen off in terms of popularity and commercial success, and I try to figure out what happened. Now, I don't really get nostalgic all that much. I'm just kind of not that sort of person, but today we're going to talk about something that gets me very nostalgic, like I just shotgunned a gallon jug of memberberry juice, and that is pop punk. So in this one, I'm going to focus on two specific areas. The first is what I would call the golden years of pop punk, the early to mid-2000s when Blink-182 and Newfound Glory were on TRL every day, when there was a new American Pie knockoff movie coming out every other week with a band like Mest in the trailer, and when you weren't shit unless you had an Atticus shirt and a pair of Draven shoes. I'm talking about bands that sound like this. Or this. And the second is the mini pop punk boom of maybe 2011 to 2015 or so, when bands like The Story So Far and The Wonder Years and Real Friends came along, when everybody got the Macklemore haircut and a Telecaster and a flannel shirt, pop punk got very serious for a minute there, and I thought maybe there was gonna be a little bit of a comeback. And if you're not familiar with this stuff, I'm talking about bands that sound like this. I'm not where I should be, I'm not what I could be. Or this. But it didn't happen, it just kind of fizzled. So what happened? Why did the pop punk bubble burst twice? Well, I think I've got a pretty good idea, and I'm gonna do my very best to explain it in this video. And before I get into it, two quick things. First of all, I've been posting on Instagram a lot more lately. I would love it if you give me a follow over there if you like this video or any of my other videos. There's a link to my Instagram in the description. And second, I also made a Spotify playlist for this, as a lot of you guys have asked for. There's also a link to that in the description. So with that out of the way, let's get into it.
Part one, setting the stage. Now, this video is not intended to be the history of pop punk, but I do want to get into the history just a bit so we can understand why the pop punk boom of the 2000s was so crazy to me. Basically, back when I was getting into pop punk in the early 90s, there were essentially four flavors of it. And by the way, this is not intended to be a definitive list of bands or anything like that, so please, please do not bother commenting telling me that I forgot this band or that band. Just please don't do it. First, the skatepunk flavor. This basically refers to all the Epitaph and Fat Records bands that sounded like NOFX, Pennywise, Face to Face, all that stuff. For example, I actually did a whole video about skatepunk, so if you want more detail about this scene, go watch that video. I'll put a link in the description. But basically, back in the 90s, this was by far the most popular stuff under the pop punk umbrella, with of course the obvious exception of Green Day that were bigger than everything else combined. Second, the Ramones core flavor. This is basically all the bands that sounded like Screeching Weasel, The Queers, and The Vindictives, who in turn were pretty much just variations on the Ramones. For example, I personally never really liked this style all that much, partly because I thought most of the bands were very generic and derivative. For example, how all three of these bands put out an entire album of Ramones covers, which is admittedly a pretty funny joke, but it also, I think, says a lot about the lack of creativity in that scene. And the other thing that turned me off to this scene is that the people in it tended to be, honestly, really negative, just basically total dicks who would take pride in being asshole gatekeepers. And third, the Lookout flavor. This was very specifically tied to the scene in the Bay Area around the venue 924 Gilman Street and Lookout Records. Green Day was obviously the defining band of this scene, along with some others like Crimp Shrine, J Church, and Jawbreaker. For example, one plus one. I didn't like the sound of these bands all that much, but this scene, the Bay Area, Gilman, punk, and hardcore scene of the early 90s was absolutely life-changing to me. If you're interested in more about that, I actually made a whole video about that scene and about Green Day, which is one of my favorite ones on the channel. Again, I'll put a link in the description. And lastly, my personal favorite flavor of pop punk back in the 90s, the Cruise Records flavor. This scene was really only a handful of bands. There were not many bands playing this style. The main ones were all Descendents and Big Drill Car. There's also Chemical People and a few other bands. But my personal favorite of the bunch was All, especially the really weird stuff that nobody seems to like their album All Roy Saves. I ain't got a And the reason I love this stuff is because it was really experimental and progressive, very, very nerdy, which is of course the exact reason why it also wasn't very popular. And I know what you're thinking, what the fuck are you talking about? The Descendents are legends, what do you mean it wasn't that popular? And this is true now, but remember, I'm talking about the early 90s, and they were way, way less popular back then. It actually wasn't until Everything Sucks came out in, I think, 96, that they really popped, and that was thanks to the marketing and distribution of Epitaph, who were finally able to surface this band to a bigger audience. So that's kind of an overview of the four different flavors back in the early days. And the thing you need to understand is that pop punk was definitely not cool back then. It was basically the redheaded stepchild of the punk scene. It was for the kids that the quote-unquote real punks made fun of because they weren't hardcore enough to listen to Discharge or GBH or whatever was cool to the kind of people that walk around with the crust punk butt flaps. But the tables were about to turn, which brings me to part number two, the extinction event from roughly 1994 to 1998. Okay, so you remember how there was that big comet that came out of nowhere and killed all the dinosaurs? Well, that's basically what happened to pop punk in 1994, except instead of a comet, it was Green Day and the Offspring and then Rancid a year later, and instead of dinosaurs, it was all the other pop punk bands. I talked about this in a lot more detail in my videos about skatepunk and Green Day, so if you want more detail about that, then check those videos out. But to make a long story short, once those bands blew up, it was basically all over for the Ramones core and Cruise style bands. I guess it's an imperfect analogy because those styles didn't go completely extinct, but they might as well have, because in terms of pop punk in the mid to late 90s, all people cared about at that time was Green Day, NOFX, The Offspring, and all the Epitaph and Fat Records bands that sounded like them. The comet came out of the sky, killed everything but Green Day and skatepunk. But anyway, the significant thing here is that pop punk was now mainstream, where even just a few years before, like I said, pop punk was a niche within a niche. It wasn't even cool within the already uncool genre of punk. Now it was literally at the top of the Billboard charts. It was on the cover of every magazine. It was all over MTV. It sounds so strange to me to say it now because it's so different from how things are these days. But in the mid 90s, everybody listened to Green Day and The Offspring, and Rancid weren't quite that big, but they were still big enough that it wasn't really unusual to catch the football team playing them in the weight room or a normie girl listening to them on the way to school. But the main point to take away here is that thanks to Green Day and The Offspring, pop punk was officially mainstream. And all of this set the stage for the next era, which is really the focus of this video. Part 3, the golden age of pop punk from roughly 1999 to 2005. I call these the golden years because this is when, at least to me, pop punk was on top of the world. This is when pop punk, and specifically that PG-13 version of it as popularized by Blink-182, Newfound Glory, and Sum 41, was as mainstream then as Drake and Cardi B are in 2019. It was basically the soundtrack for being a middle-class teenager or a young adult, again the same way that Drake or Cardi B would be today. And I guess depending on who you ask, that would either be the best thing ever or the worst thing ever. For some of us, it was an awesome time to be around. It was full of great memories of putting on your best Famous Stars and Straps shirt, your Dickies and Draven shoes, and going to the mall and trying unsuccessfully to flirt with the girl who works at Jamba Juice. And for others, it was a fate worse than death. It was a living nightmare because they were surrounded by posers that were killing punk rock one Blink-182 album at a time. And as you might guess, I'm definitely closer to the first category. I love this stuff, even though it was admittedly corny at times. I could never get into Good Charlotte, for example, due to the corniness factor. That was just a bridge too far for me. So I get why it's not for everyone, but I do look back on this stuff with a lot of fond memories. And if you made it this far, I'm guessing that you already know a lot of these bands, but I wanted to mention a few of my favorite bands that never got to the Blink-182 or Newfound Glory level, but deserve some recognition. Fenix TX. Messed. Fucked up visions in my head. I'm a fucked up kid, is what they said. The Starting Line. Say what you're thinking right now. Tell me what you thought about when you were gone and so alone. Unwritten Law. Find out I'm the one, and I still feel lonesome. And Homegrown. And there's a million other bands like Rufio, Cartel, Simple Plan, Yellow Card, Alistair, The Ataris. I could go on forever. This is such a great time for the genre with so many bands. I think this was also a great time for labels, with some of the most notable ones being, of course, Fat Records, but also Nitro, Honest Dawns, No Idea, and in my opinion, the definitive label of this era, Drive Thru Records. It was a glorious time to be a fan, but like all good things, it couldn't last forever. Which brings me to part 4, the emo takeover from roughly 2005 to 2008. Ironically, the thing that was key to the rise of pop punk was also responsible for its fall. The PG-13, jackass, guys in Hurley shirts, horsing around, and playing pranks at the mall kind of vibe that I mentioned earlier. That vibe is what made it appealing to mainstream suburban teenagers. For example, it was basically the perfect fit for all those American Pie style raunchy booby comedy movies that were super popular at the time. But I think it's also what led to the downfall as the audience grew up and that vibe started to get a little old. Because as much as I love this stuff, if we're being honest, it is pretty juvenile, and if you're still identifying with the lyrics to homegrown songs in your mid-20s, that's probably not a good thing. Basically, I think the people who were listening to this stuff in 2004 went in two directions. The ones who were on the normie side of things, who just listened to whatever was on MTV or radio, well, they just moved on to the next thing because they were never really core fans of pop punk to begin with. And the weird kids, the people like you and me who were core fans, they got into more quote-unquote credible, mature genres like hardcore, metal, or indie. And in addition to their old fans growing out of pop punk, the bands had another problem in that the new crop of kids who would have listened to the drive-thru bands were instead getting into the new emo-influenced sounds of bands like My Chemical Romance and the Fueled By Ramen bands like Fall Out Boy and Paramore. I think this changing of the guard was an important inflection point because this is when it was basically no longer for normies. Bands like Blink, Newfound Glory, and Sum 41 were mainstream bands to the point that, like I said, even normies listened to them, but by contrast, the new emo stuff was definitely not for normies. Now, it wasn't underground or anything like that, but it was definitely quote-unquote alternative, for lack of a better word. And of course, later in their careers, Fall Out Boy and Paramore became basically mainstream pop bands, but in 2005 or 2007, they definitely fell more on the alternative side of the spectrum versus the other artists who were breaking through at the time, like Kanye, Rihanna, Chris Brown, and a bunch of other people that have gone on to become household names. And in hindsight, it was actually bigger than just pop punk. This was really the start of a new era in which normies basically didn't listen to rock very much. This is when the soundtrack to being a normie shifted away from rock and towards rap, pop, and R&B. Pop punk wasn't exactly dead, but by the mid-2000s, it had definitely taken a big fall. It was on some pretty heavy pain meds, and it was kind of dormant for a few years as metalcore and neon pop bands like Metro Station took the spotlight. And as you know, if you've seen my other videos, I do love metalcore, so I was fine with that for the most part, but I did miss pop punk, which is why I got pretty excited about the next phase, part 5, Newfound Glory's hardcore side quest. Although pop punk was dormant, there was something important happening below the surface. There was one band that was laying the foundation for the genre's kinda sorta rebirth that was about to come, and that band was Newfound Glory. And let me quickly rewind the tape a little bit to kind of frame this and give you a little bit of context. Those of you who were born in the 90s obviously weren't around for Newfound Glory's initial rise, but they were absolutely hated by everybody in the quote-unquote real punk and hardcore scenes. They were seen as corny mall punk posers that had absolutely no credibility, basically the same way people would talk about All Time Low or something these days. But as many of you probably know, the band actually has roots in hardcore. Chad Gilbert comes from the South Florida hardcore scene, he was briefly in Shai Hulud, and their first album came out on Eulogy Recordings, home to many South Florida hardcore bands like Morning Again and Until the End. And although they strayed pretty far from those hardcore roots during their MTV days, the older they got, the closer they became to the hardcore scene. As a couple examples, Chad did a band called Hazen Street with members of Madball, Cro-Mags, and H2O, and the whole band did a joke hardcore side project called the International Super Heroes of Hardcore, where they used fake names like Mr. Mosh, The Amazing Breakdown, and Chugga Chugga. They were kind of always in orbit of the hardcore scene. I remember the first time I met Chad was when he came to a Suffocate Faster show in Dayton, Ohio in 2005 or so. And the reason I mention all this is because it was why they slowly but surely went from a band that everybody made fun of to a respected, influential band that is, in my opinion, more or less single-handedly responsible for inspiring the next wave of pop punk. That next wave was essentially defined by what they did by bringing the influence of DIY culture to pop punk, in particular hardcore and quote-unquote real emo. And before I move on, for any of you who are wondering why I'm not talking about easycore here, it's because I made a whole video about that, so if you haven't seen it and you're interested, check it out, there's a link in the description. With that said, moving on, that brings us to part 6, the revival that wasn't, from roughly 2011 to 2015. After laying somewhat dormant for a half decade or so, pop punk was suddenly full of life. Around 2010, 2011, there was this flood of new bands that called themselves pop punk, but were very different from the pop punk bands of the previous generation. There are way, way more of these bands that I could possibly mention, but basically I'm talking about bands like The Story So Far, The Wonder Years, Neck Deep, Real Friends, and Knuckle Puck. Bands that play that emo, hardcore influence pop punk with, as somebody in my comments said, shouty vocals with lyrics about a girl. Basically, bands that sound like this. My mind was a fortress, you knew And then there were the so-called soft grunge bands like Tidal Fight, Basement, and Citizen, which got lumped in with pop punk, I think because they were kind of from the same scene, although they didn't sound either pop or punk to me. They actually had more in common with 90s alternative rock like Sonic Youth than they did Newfound Glory or The Descendents, in my opinion. But like I said, they were, for whatever reason, considered part of the pop punk scene. For example... And really quickly, before I go on, I just wanted to pay respects to Tim from Transit, who unfortunately died a few days before I filmed this. RIP, Tim. We lost a good one. Anyhow, the defining thing about this wave of bands was the huge contrast from the Golden Years bands, both sonically and thematically. These bands were much more emotional, serious, and dark with both their lyrics and their music. It was a world apart from the days of writing about farts and throwing a ska song in every album. It felt fresh, it felt relevant, and people were feeling it. There was a lot of hype for this stuff, with The Story So Far and The Wonder Years getting a ton of attention on Tumblr, which was super relevant at the time, Tidal Fight getting all kinds of love from the press, and I thought maybe this stuff was going to be a bit of a comeback. Probably not as big as the Golden Years, but I thought at least one of these bands would break through into something close to mainstream success, especially State Champs when they got a lot poppier on their 2015 album Around the World and Back. But it kind of just didn't happen. I guess it wasn't meant to be. And although pretty much all these bands are still around in some form, and some, like The Story So Far, The Wonder Years, and State Champs are definitely doing well, none of them blew up like I thought they might. So what happened? Why did the pop punk bubble burst for a second time? Well, that brings us to part 6, present day. To make a long story short, I think what it comes down to is that rap is the new pop punk and emo. Of course, there are still pop punk bands around, like I said earlier, and plenty of the older bands are still doing well. It's obvious that it's a shell of what it used to be, in large part because the most talented and charismatic people who would have started pop punk bands a few years ago are now doing SoundCloud rap instead. And by extension, the fans who would have followed those pop punk bands are now following rappers instead. The most obvious example of this is Wicca Phase Springs Eternal, which is the quote-unquote rap name of Adam from the soft grunge band Tiger's Jaw. They were one of the hype bands of that scene, along with maybe like Joyce Manor and Balance and Composure and Tidal Fight, and now as a rapper, he's collaborated with some absolutely massive names like Lil Peep, Clams Casino, and Lil B. Shout out to Lil B, the father of internet rap. There's nobody there, me and you alone, when you leave for work, when I sleep at home. But he's far from the only one who has a foot in both worlds. As a couple examples that I've talked about before, Shakewell was in the metalcore band Betrayal, Ghostmane had a hardcore band called Nemesis, and now plays with a band that has members of Twitching Tongues in it. And like I mentioned before, my good friend Michael Montoya from Winds of Plague is a producer who's done stuff with Lil Xan, Bones, Scarlord, among many, many others. Basically, what it comes down to is that rappers like Lil Peep and Nothing Nowhere are this generation's My Chemical Romance. Lil Uzi Vert is this generation's Fall Out Boy. And then next wave of rap is essentially guys who look like they're in 2000s pop punk or emo bands playing songs that sound like 2000s pop punk or emo, just with 808s instead of drums. Here's a couple examples aside from the names that I mentioned above. Lil Aaron. Lil Lotus. Basically all the rappers with Lil in their name who have a bunch of face tattoos and shoot a video in a parking garage. So that's where we're at today. Rap is the new pop punk, is the new emo, but who knows where we'll go from here. And just to be clear, I like a lot of this stuff, and I actually think it's a lot more creative and interesting than almost everything rock bands are doing, but I'll admit that it does feel a little bit weird that basically bands are not really a thing in this new world. That said, I kind of think that these rappers, the ones who are starting to use a lot more guitars, more sung vocals, and shout out artists like Blink-182 and even Escape the Fate, I kind of think that they're going to inspire a new generation of bands. They're drawing a lot of attention to this stuff, and I have to think it's going to inspire some kids to pick up guitars and drums and start a band. But on the other hand, it's also a lot easier for a kid to download a beat off YouTube and rap over it than it is to find three or four friends, come up with the money to buy instruments, and get into a studio. So, I don't know, maybe this is it for rock in the mainstream. I guess only time will tell, but in the meantime, I'll be over here watching American Pie and listening to the Unwritten Law discography on repeat.
Alright guys, that was my thoughts on what killed pop punk. I want to hear from you now. Let me know in the comments, what were your favorite pop punk bands? What were the key moments to you in the history of the genre? And why do you think it fell off? Are we going to see a comeback? What do you think about the idea that these SoundCloud rappers are potentially going to inspire a new generation of kids to start bands? I'm really interested to see how that's going to play out. I would love to know what you guys think. And just a quick reminder, there's a Spotify playlist in this video where I include a lot of the songs I talked about in this video, as well as a whole bunch of my other favorite pop punk songs that I couldn't cover in this video. There's a link to that in the description. And also, I would love it if you give me a follow over on Instagram. I've been posting a lot of pretty great shit on there. So if you like this video or any of my other videos, there's also a link to my Instagram in the description. I would love it if you give me a follow over there. And with that, I'm going to sign out for now, but I will see you next time.